Hello everybody! Today, we'll be talking about topic 2.4. Now be careful, this is not the first video on topic 2.4. In fact, there have been several others. Make sure you watch those ones first, as they all build on each other. We've already spoken about the structure of proteins and other major biomolecules. Today, we're going to be talking more specifically about the structures of polypeptides, so the polymers of proteins, and also their many functions in our bodies and our cells. So let's dive right in. As a quick bit of review, remember that amino acids are linked together by condensation reactions to form polypeptides. Moreover, there are 20 different amino acids that can be linked together to make these different polypeptides. Now these are made by ribosomes. What are ribosomes? Ribosomes are basically like enzymes. They are small molecular machines that facilitate making the peptide bonds between amino acids. And what that means is ribosomes are where polypeptides are made. And this is kind of what a ribosome looks like. You've probably already drawn prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. And in those drawings, you have to draw 70S or 80S ribosomes. Those ribosomes are usually drawn as dots. So these are those ribosomes that make proteins. Now again, there are 20 different amino acids, and ribosomes use the 20 different amino acids to make polypeptides. There are actually 22 different ones, but not naturally. The number you need to know is 20. And basically, they can be edited to make the others. So amino acids can be linked together in any sequence, giving a huge range of polypeptides. In my previous video, I compared monomers to Lego pieces or bricks, and I talked about how these pieces can be put together to make bigger molecules. Now, amino acids are the Lego pieces of proteins, and there are 20 different types of pieces that can be linked together in any sequence to give a huge range of polypeptides. So, if you ask me how many types of Lego bricks are there, I can Google the answer. If you ask me how many things can you make out of Legos, the answer is basically infinite. You can make anything you want out of Legos. Same thing with proteins. There are 20 amino acids, but they can be put together in basically an infinite number of ways. There's essentially an infinite number of polypeptides that can be made. They're always in long chains of amino acids, but these chains can be any length. And there are 20 different amino acids, so any one of these 20 can be in any position. So think of it almost like text. We have 26 letters in the English alphabet, and letters can be reused in a word. They make a chain. How many different words can you make? Basically an infinite number. You can reuse letters, you can use whichever ones you want, and they can be almost any length. So you really get an almost infinite combination that you can use. Now, how many options are there for the very first letter in a word? 26. So in theory, there are 26 possible one-letter words. How many possible two-letter words would there be? Well, 26 times 26. The same basic idea works for proteins. How many one amino acid proteins can there be? 20. How many two amino acid ones can there be? 20 times 20. Three amino acid ones? 20 times 20 times 20. Etc., etc. An average protein or polypeptide is around 300 amino acids long. 20 options. So 20 times 20 times 20 times 20, 300 times, is actually a number bigger than the number of atoms in the universe. So again, an almost infinite number. Now, by the way, if 300 amino acids long is the length of a normal polypeptide, how long is the longest one? The longest one is about 30,000 amino acids long. Just like the Titans of Greek legends, this is named Titan. So this protein actually has 30,000 amino acids. So huge numbers of proteins are possible. Now, the amino acid sequence, that means the order of amino acids in a polypeptide, just like the order of letters in a word, A-M-I-N-O, right? The order of letters in a word. The order of amino acids in a polypeptide is coded for by your DNA, by your genes. So what happens is that ribosomes will actually read instructions from your DNA to make proteins. We are going to have several topics on all of this. In fact, it's a full unit in my class. So I'm not going to go in too much depth now. For now, all I really want you to know is that what the word gene means, and you need to know that ribosomes read information from your genes to make polypeptides. There are two basic processes to do this, transcription and translation, where DNA is copied, then that copy is read by ribosomes. Again, I'm not going to go in more detail now. That said, you have to know what a gene is. And a gene is a sequence of DNA, it's a section of DNA that codes for a protein. Now, people used to think that one gene would code for just one polypeptide, one protein. But this idea we now know is wrong because there's actually way more proteins than genes. Now, that doesn't really make sense because if genes are DNA that codes for proteins, how can there be proteins that didn't come from the code of a gene? And basically, we now know that the genes, the information in that DNA, can be slightly edited before it actually gets translated into proteins. So there are ways of essentially editing the proteins while they're in the manufacturing process. The details of this are more than standard levels will ever need to know. Higher levels, we're going to study that in our higher level unit on translation. For now, just know that there are more proteins than genes, but that genes are sections of DNA that code for proteins. So, let's actually dive into the structure of proteins. So the amino acid sequence, like the order of amino acids in a protein, just like the order of letters in a word, will determine the three-dimensional shape of that protein. So there are actually four levels of protein structure. And up to now, I've really only been talking about the first one. The first level of protein structure, which is called primary structure, is really just the order of amino acids in a chain. That's all it is. So if I go through the full chain, I'm really just looking at what are the amino acids in there. So there are 20 different ones. If you count the colors, there's 20 colors in this chain. And if I ask you for the primary structure of a protein, all I'm asking you for is the order of amino acids in that protein. That is primary structure. Now, I said there are four levels of structure. Can you guess what the other four are named? And I'm glad to confirm that they have very logical names. The first one is primary, the second one is secondary, the third one is tertiary, and the fourth one is quaternary. So let me give a brief summary of what these are, and then we'll go through in a bit more detail. But the primary structure of a protein is the order of amino acids in the chain. Now, because amino acids often interact in predictable ways, specifically if you're in chemistry, this is due to hydrogen bonds, there are shapes that will happen in almost every polypeptide. These super common shapes, basically a spiral called an alpha helix, and a folding pattern called a beta pleated sheet. These are the secondary structures. They're the most common ones, and they happen because of hydrogen bonding. Now, once you have these secondary structures, so once your chain has been turned into a spiral or folds, these will sometimes fold on top of each other to make a 3D ball. And here you can see there's an alpha helix here, there's a beta pleated sheet here, and they kind of fold on top of each other. And this 3D ball, 3 means tertiary, the third level of structure, is the 3D shapes that happen when alpha helices and beta pleated sheets fold on top of each other. Now finally, the fourth level of structure, the quaternary structure, is when more than one chain interacts. So for example, hemoglobin in your blood is actually made of 4 polypeptides that got stuck together. Think about talking about the structure of one hand versus something like a prayer where I hold 2 hands together. This is a structure involving 2 different hands. Quaternary structure is structure involving more than one protein, 2 proteins, 3 proteins, 4 proteins, etc. So, again, the primary structure is just the amino acid sequence. Which amino acids are in which order? And that makes unique chains. Now, every amino acid is different. You know, they have different R groups. Some of them are polar. Some amino acids are nonpolar. Some have a charge. Some contain metals that can form metallic bonds with each other. So they form interactions with each other that fold up. So the hydrophobic ones end up on the inside of the protein, the hydrophilic ones on the outside, the ones that make hydrogen bonds will make hydrogen bonds together, etc., etc., etc. The most common interactions are hydrophilic hydrophobic ones, hydrogen bonds, or ionic bonds are the most common ones. And that allows the chain to fold up into a 3-dimensional shape. So you basically go from this essentially 1-dimensional line to a 3-dimensional shape. And here you can see some alpha helices, and I don't see any beta pleated sheets in this structure. Now, there are 2 main ways that it can fold. Sometimes they fold in a way that is very linear, and that gives us what we call fibrous proteins that look like fibers or string. Sometimes they really fold into a ball, and that's a globular protein, like a glob of something. So fibrous proteins are long strings or sheets, usually dominated by hydrogen bonds, meaning alpha helices and beta pleated sheets. Because they are so long, they don't really dissolve in water, so they are insoluble. Now, because of these really, this length in them, they have great strength and stretchiness. So collagen, which helps hold your skin together, is made of fibrous proteins. Actin and myosin in your blood, you know, if you actually feel, in your muscles, if you feel your muscles, like your bicep, you can actually feel the strings in them. These strings are protein strings. They are fibrous proteins, which are the most common type of proteins in animals. So again, fibrous proteins are just these long strings. They are string-shaped, dominated by hydrogen bonds, and mostly made of alpha helices or beta pleated sheets in one long line. As opposed to globular proteins. Globular proteins have this more compact round shape. And in fact, the word glob really makes me think of a round shape. They're folded into this 3D conformation, and they tend to be dominated by interactions between the R groups. You might remember that anything can be in an R group, and what that means is basically any type of bond can happen here. Ionic, metallic, disulfide, hydrophobic, hydrophilic interactions, all of these can make a protein globular. Now, because they are globular, they tend to be water soluble. That means they can dissolve in water. Because of that, they tend to be things like transport proteins, pigments, enzymes as well are globular proteins, or your immunoglobulins, also known as your antibodies. So globular proteins are things like enzymes, like catalase, and you can see here the alpha helices and the beta pleated sheets, which have folded on top of each other to make a 3-dimensional ball. So fibrous proteins are long and narrow, while globular proteins are round. Fibrous proteins are usually structural, while globular proteins are often enzymes. Fibrous proteins cannot dissolve in water, while globular proteins can. Fibrous proteins are dominated by alpha helices and beta pleated sheets. Secondary structure. In this box, write secondary structure. Globular proteins are dominated by tertiary structure. So again, fibrous proteins are dominated by secondary structure, while globular proteins are dominated by tertiary structure. Now, by the way, that means globular proteins do still have primary and secondary structure, but fibrous proteins often have less tertiary structure. They have more secondary structure. Going on, fibrous proteins tend to be more stable, globular proteins less stable, and some examples, fibrous proteins are things like collagen in your skin, or fibrin that causes your blood to clot, while globular proteins are enzymes like catalase or hemoglobin or insulin. So, again, from there you can get into quaternary structure, where proteins may consist of more than one polypeptide linked together. So many proteins actually have some quaternary structure, where one polypeptide is linked to something else, like another polypeptide, or a non-proteinaceous molecule. For example, in hemoglobin, it's quaternary for two reasons. The hemoglobin protein has four polypeptides and a piece of iron that they are organized around. So again, here is hemoglobin, and we can actually see iron and four different proteins, which in this case are colored red, blue, purple, and green. So the four levels of protein structure. Primary structure is the order of amino acids. Secondary structure are alpha helices and beta pleated sheets dominated by hydrogen bonds. Tertiary structure is the 3D folding of the alpha helices and beta pleated sheets, which is caused by any other type of bond. And quaternary structure is when there are more than one protein or other things attached to the protein. Fibrous proteins are dominated by secondary structure and used mostly for structural functions like your muscles or collagen. They are insoluble in water. Globular proteins are dominated by tertiary structure. They're often enzymes. They dissolve in water. Now, all of these layers together go to make some beautiful structures. Here you can see that they're color-coded just so we can see the 3D shape of it. And you can see these alpha helices, these spirals in there, and beta-pleated sheets making some really cool structures. Now, living organisms need proteins to function because proteins have so many different roles in our bodies. Let's talk about the roles that they do have. Because really in your body, they are the most versatile type of molecule. While carbohydrates and fats are, carbohydrates are really just for energy. Fats are mostly for energy, but can also keep you warm or help you float if you're a whale or something. And DNA is really for storing information. Proteins can do tons of things, and they're so useful that we even use them in biotechnology. For example, you might have soaps that are bioenzymatic or bioenzimatico, which means they help break down or digest stains in your clothes. Monoclonal antibodies are used for pregnancy tests, insulin shots if you're diabetic, and many disease treatments are based on proteins as well. So I have an acronym to help you memorize the functions of proteins. Probably my favorite acronym is either TRACI or SMART-ME. Here I'm going to talk about SMART-ME, where there is structural functions like collagen or the cytoskeleton, marker proteins which help identify your cells, adhesion between cells helping to hold them together, receptor proteins, and transport proteins like channels and pumps. Muscles help contract and move things, move your body. And then enzymes speed up all the reactions. Two that didn't really fit in here are hormones. Some hormones are proteins as well, and your antibodies or immunoglobulins. So if you see another acronym called TRACI, TRACI has transport, receptors, adhesion, and then cell-to-cell communication, which is talking about marker proteins, immunoglobulins for your immune system, and enzymes. I prefer SmartMe because it actually has a few more. But all these functions are important in your body, and they're all done by proteins. Now, there are actually 6 proteins you are required to know the functions of: Rubisco, insulin, immunoglobulins, rhodopsin, collagen, and spider silk as examples of the range of protein functions. So, Rubisco is an enzyme that does photosynthesis. And this is probably my favorite enzyme in the world. It's short. Rubisco is actually short for ribulose, bisphosphate, carboxylase. So Rubisco, you do not need to know that. And the reason I love Rubisco is Rubisco actually takes CO2 from the air, literally the carbon dioxide I exhale, and turns it into food, sugar. This is how plants make food from thin air. And that is super cool. So you find Rubisco in plants for photosynthesis. Next, we have insulin. Insulin is a hormone that tells your body when to absorb glucose. If you don't produce enough insulin, you are type 1 diabetic, so you need injections of it instead. So insulin is a hormone. Rubisco was an enzyme. Insulin is a hormone. Next, antibodies. Antibodies are also known as immunoglobulins. They have these arms that can help them attach to pathogens like viruses and bacteria. And here we see another side or function of proteins as part of your immune system, immunoglobulins. Next, rhodopsin. Rhodopsin is a receptor protein. It actually detects light. Literally, you are using rhodopsin right now to watch this video. Rhodopsin is an integral protein inside the cell membrane, and it actually changes shape when photons of light hit it. So here is a cell that detects light, and in this outer segment of the cell, you have rhodopsin, which detects light energy, changing its shape and telling your cells, which then tells your brain, that you're seeing things. Rhodopsin is the receptor that helps you see. Next, we have collagen. Collagen is a fibrous protein which has structural function. And that totally makes sense. Fibrous proteins are usually structural. Collagen helps hold your skin together. It's a mesh, this extracellular matrix, that resists tearing, giving strength to your skin, as well as your tendons, ligaments, etc. There's also some collagen in parts of your teeth and bones to prevent cracks. Finally, also serving a bit of a structural function, there's spider silk. If you've ever admired a beautiful spider's web, these spider webs are actually made of proteins that the spiders are excreting. Spider silk is extremely strong. It is so hard to break that, in fact, police bulletproof vests are based on spider silk as a design. Super, super cool. So Kevlar is made of, or at least inspired by, the protein in spider silk. So those are 6 examples of proteins that you are required to know. Rubisco is an enzyme. Insulin is a hormone. Immunoglobulins are antibodies for your immune system. Rhodopsin is a receptor to detect light. Collagen is a structural protein to hold your skin together. And spider silk makes spider webs, and again is a structural protein. That's about all you need to know about them. So, how can you break a protein? When you break a protein, we say that it has lost its nature. It has denatured. So, denaturation is when a protein changes shape so much that it does not do its function anymore. It stops working. And proteins will denature because of heat or because of acid or base. So, as a protein is made, it rolls up into a very specific 3D shape, which comes from the secondary and tertiary structure. If you break the bonds, the protein will never go back into the right shape. Think of it a little bit like putting a car engine together. Your car engine has a very specific shape. If I take it apart and then put the pieces back together, if they're not in exactly the right place, the car engine won't work. You can also think of this as overheating your car, right? So if I talk about heat, if I overheat your car engine, literally if it melts a little bit, all the same atoms are there, but they're in a different place and that doesn't work anymore. When a protein loses its ability to function because of a change in its shape, we say that it has denatured. And when a protein denatures, it's usually permanent. You cannot undo it. Factors that denature proteins include heat, because the hotter a molecule moves, the faster it's moving, and eventually it moves so fast that those molecules break their bonds, thus breaking the shape of a protein. Meanwhile, pH, high pHs are bases or alkali, same thing. Low pHs are acids. For now, don't worry too much about that, but changes in pH can mess up the bonds as well, changing the shape of a protein and denaturing it. One way you can see denaturation happening at home is just looking at an egg. If you heat up an egg, you can actually see the molecules changing. And once you've cooked an egg and denatured all the proteins in it, it's permanent. You can't undo it. You cannot go back to a raw egg. Okay, the last idea for the day. We spoke about the relationship between genes and proteins. Genes are pieces of DNA that code for proteins. Now we have this word, the genome, and the genome is all of the genetic information in an organism, including all the genes. But it really is all the genetic information, all the DNA. Now, a genome is unique to most people, but identical twins have exactly the same genome. Clones would have exactly the same genome. So it's not 100% unique. But yours is probably unique unless you're an identical twin. The other thing that's interesting is your genome will stay the same your entire life. The DNA you're born with is the DNA you will die with. Your proteome is all the proteins in an organism or in your body. And what's interesting is it's very different from your genome, because not all the genes you have are used. We'll study that more when we study genetics, but we've talked a little bit about this when we talked about differentiation. The idea that my skin cells are reading some parts of the DNA that muscle cells are not, and vice versa. So, depending on the environment, depending on the part of your body, different genes are made. And proteins can be edited after they are made. And different proteins can be joined together in quaternary structure, and they can fold, etc. That means there are many, many more genes than proteins. While there's around 20,000 genes, there's around up to 1 million proteins. The proteome is way bigger than the genome. And the proteome changes over time. Depending on what you eat, your body will make different proteins. Proteome effects can be passed down to a certain extent, so children of starving people will have affected proteomes. And because the proteome is affected by what's happening to you, identical twins and clones would have different proteomes, even though they have the same DNA. So, every individual has a unique proteome. And on that note, we're done for the day. Thanks so much for watching, and have a great rest of your day. Ciao!